favor have spoken. We will then have the following speakers that have requested in writing to speak against the 2 a.m. closing. Today I have the police commissioner, Kevin Carpenter. After he makes his presentation, speakers that are against the 2 a.m. closing will have 3 minutes to speak. This meeting will end at 8 p.m. It may need to be continued to a later date to be determined. So understand that if all speakers have not had the opportunity to state their views, there will be no decision made tonight. Now the rules for this public hearing are as follows. No cell phone use. All cells should be on site. All speakers are limited to speak only once for 3 minutes unless a written request has been submitted. All speakers are to state their name and address and sign in at the podium with your name and address. This is required. There will be no tolerance for verbal outbursts. You will be removed from this hearing. The records of all pouring establishments in the city of Lynn will be considered as part of the record of this hearing. Is there anyone besides the media representatives recording this hearing? Would you please provide this board with a copy of your recording? Lastly, as you know, any attorney representing a pouring establishment in Lynn and wishes to speak must present a notice of appearance. So we will begin with our administrative assistant, Mrs. Genovan, reading our Honorable Mayor Judith Flanagan Kennedy's letter.
July 21st, 2015, Lynn License Commission, care of Chairperson Patricia Barton, Lynn City Hall, Lynn, Mass. 01901. Dear Commission members, I would like to express my support for extending the operating hours for licensed pouring establishments and respectfully ask that the License Commission approve a trial period of extended hours with the following conditions. Effective immediately, the establishments can return to 2 a.m. closing time on a trial basis, Fridays, Saturdays, and Sundays through November 1st, 2015. At the October 2015 meeting, the License Commission, the Commission shall determine whether to extend the trial period, expand the days of the week with late closing, and impose additional rules and restrictions or reduce or terminate the late closing arrangements. Effective immediately, any establishment that chooses to remain open until 2 a.m. will stop admitting persons at 12:30 a.m. Once the patron leaves the establishment prior to 12:30 a.m., even temporarily as to smoke or get something from their cars, they will not be allowed to re-enter. Any establishment found by the License Commission to be violating this rule will immediately have its closing time returned to 1 a.m. for the duration of the trial period. Effective immediately, any establishment found by the License Commission to be creating excessive noise or other disturbances during the extended hours may, in the discretion of the Commission, have its closing time returned to 1 a.m. for the duration of the trial period. I am available to discuss this proposal further if you so desire. Thank you for your consideration. Sincerely, Judith Flanagan Kennedy, Mayor of the City of Lynn.
Thank you.
letter will be entered into the records consideration. Okay, at this time, we'll begin with Attorney Frederick Riley, representing the Lynn Restaurant Association.
Chairman, members of the board, my name is Frederick W. Riley, R-I-L-E-Y, and I'm here to represent the Lynn Restaurant Association, which I entered my appearance in a couple of weeks, at least a week ago. I think it was acknowledged that it was received. Madam Chairman, members of the commission, if this was 2006, and I applied to the former board, a liquor license. And if my application is cleared and accepted by the board and granted by the board, I then go to the ABCC, as you know, the approval, and come back to you for conditions. At that time, having completed the application, having been reviewed by everybody, I would assume that if I follow the law, the liquor control law, chapter 138, section 12, that I would, and also the rules and regulations of your board, I would have assumed that I had passed muster, and I would have assumed that there would have been an agreement between us. If I complied with the rules and regulations of the board, and I was granted the application, and what I was allowed to do pursuant to that application, I would have been allowed to open to 2 a.m. That would have been what I would have understood, an agreement between the parties. Well, the next day, I woke up one day as an applicant, and I did everything right. I was a good citizen to live. I complied with all the laws. I ran my business well. And I woke up and I found that there was a rollback. From 12, I was straight there for 2, to 1 o'clock. Well, you can imagine how I felt after doing everything correctly pursuant to the law. Now, if this was a systemic problem that the board, the previous board found, that is that there was a system-wide violations of the liquor law and your rules and regulations, then I could have understood the rollback. But I don't think there's a person, whether you're far road, you know, for the 2 o'clock license or the 1 o'clock rollback, I don't think there's a person in this auditorium who can say that there was a systemic problem in the city with the licensing, specifically section 12, I'll speak for them directly. If there had been, like I said, then I would have said, well, that was probably zero. I first got involved in this case, strike that actually before the case, when I was chairman of the ABCC. The previous mayor had come to me and he had a problem. Several liquor licenses. And he asked for my help, and I did. I assigned 2 investigators full time, then vice squad, for as long as he thought we would need it. And if we needed more resources from us, then we'd be glad to provide them. And the reason, not only was he the city impressed in help, which I would have done to anybody, but I had practiced law here for 4.5 years in Central Square before I went to the Attorney General's office. So I had a special affinity for the city at the age. But I assigned those people. Imagine my hour of surprise. 7 years later, I was asked by the Lynn Association, the Restaurant Association, to represent them in a rollback. It's surprising. I then learned the basis of the rollback. The basis of the rollback was going to be statistics generated by the Lynn Police Department. And those statistics were going to form the basis of the item for rollback. I requested from the city, through the city, the lawyer for the city, and to have the same police reports that the police department was going to use for the basis of the rollback. I was denied. So I went to the Superior Court, and I convinced the court to give me the court order, directing the city of Lynn to turn off those police reports. Time went by, and I got, which now Portland law called dumb, I got delivered 361 documents. Now this was in December. The hearing, as you know, I'm sorry, that November, the end of November. The hearing was in December, I think, but there was a short time to appear. Because I didn't have enough information, and when I looked at those reports, honestly, I didn't show it for you. I picked out 100 of the agreement, and I mean that's the still. I didn't cheat. It was going to fall, or it was going to fall. When I pulled those out, I examined those to the time of the report, the location, the licensee, the event that could have brought the police there, not necessarily, but could have brought the police there, because they received communication from the city solicitor that they didn't have all of the documents and matched them up. So I looked at the event, and I looked at the foreseeability, because as you know, that could be an absolute offense to a violation. And I looked at the curtilage, and as you know, if the event is outside the curtilage, then that could be an absolute offense. So when I didn't get those documents, I didn't get them all, I sent a lengthy letter, five-page letter, to the chief of police. And I explained what I was concerned with. And I explained, in order to do a thorough job, I needed Schedule A, as a Schedule A. And I requested 15 points of information to do that. Well, I never got an answer. So, it then bothered me because the police department was talking publicly that the problems in the city were drugs and the influence of gangs on a few liquor licensees. Yet, the mayor, former, said that it was petty crimes, that was the problem. And that confused me. So I have a copy of that, I can read it to you, but the couple of points that I was requesting is that the chief said that the problem was gangs and drugs and the influence of such on vice and fuel licensees. But the mayor was saying that it was a petty crime. So what was the issue to repeat? The statistics that came through, some of them were surprising. And again, I have to say to you, I do have a letter here that I can corroborate that I didn't ask for 15 pieces of information. Some of that information that I got was a surprise. For example, the Massachusetts State Police were asked to look at the operating numbers in some cities and towns. And several of the cities and towns were the following. Saugus, 36 events. Peabody, 17 events. Danvers, 8 events. Lynn, 10 events, which is an astounding figure given this population and the number of liquor licensees in the city of Lynn. So it went on, and I continued to look through the materials. And at one point, the materials, looking at them, the bulk of the incidents, violations of the liquor law, were done by 8, at the most, licensed premises. Now, those could have been repeated. I don't know because it didn't show them. The former chief then addressed that issue. And he said, he took statistics, he said, from January 06 to June of 07. And what he said, this considered, and this was relevant to violent behavior on licensed premises. And then he says, but, he said, not all of the incidents are on the licensed premises that appear in the reports. And, he said, not all of them happen between 1 a.m. and 2 a.m. And, he said, some, didn't find it, premises are more problematic than others. He then went on to say, SIU works daily with the licensees and, quote, have a good working relationship, end quote. The violent behavior that he spoke of, I looked at those that I had, and I looked at them again as to the time, the location, the licensee, the events that brought the police there, the foreseeability of the defense, and the courage of the defense. Because I didn't get an answer to Schedule A, I couldn't come to any decision that satisfied me. But it went on. So we went through this whole process, and I started to feel, and I say this with all due respect, I'm not here to cast aspersions on anybody. I'm not talking about the present situation, I'm talking about the past situation, but I'm not casting aspersions. I'm here in defense of my client to tell you what I honestly believe. And the question then started to rise in my mind. Was this prejudged? Was this hearing on the rollback already decided by the testimony? And here are some of the few of the things that led me to believe that they were. The attitude was not very friendly. And Commissioner Pace, take for example, said the following. Licensees, quote, licensees still talk about money and that's it, unquote. And he went on in that vein, not only concerned about money, not concerned about public safety. Well, that's not true. An owner, a licensee, has a family, they have a business, and they are certainly concerned with public safety. He went on to say, well, we have been threatened with body bags and more accidents, end quote. Quote again, he says he's sorry but does not see a 1 hour causing you to lose thousands, that's all, end quote. And that's the way he handled the hearing. The former chairman of the hearing said this, quote, we will be happy to assist you with anything you need. Well, what the needs were? The needs were not to target all licensees. And the need was, do more work that she was talking about, right? Started to talk about drugs and gang activity in licensed establishments. The rollback hit all. We lost it. I thought we shouldn't have, and I don't want to have. Yeah, we lost it. What did the licensees do? The restaurant association worked harder. They tried to get loans to augment the necessary needs, and still they contributed to all of the charities and sports and athletic teams and so forth in the city. They still remain good citizens of Lynn. I would like to say, if I could, a few words about, that I think are very relevant, about the situation in Revere and Saunders. And if I can have a minute. There was a lot of discussion, which you probably know even though you didn't run the board, about the rollback. Revere is also discussing that situation very seriously. And you know, December 31st, 2007, Lynn rolled back to 1 a.m. On January 10th of 2008, we rolled back to that identity, the second. A week later, Mayor Tommy Ambrosino a lawyer, he's a good man, and a good, fair guy. Mayor Ambrosino addressed on January 10th the Riviera licensing board, and here's what he said. He said, "It appears as a proponent of the change to rollback the hours from 2 a.m. to 1 a.m. I will concede that I have not always thought that that was a necessary step to take in such all-encompassing way that you are considering. But I do believe that the situation in Lynn has really changed the landscape here. And I am very concerned that with the change to 1 a.m. closing in Lynn, which is a significant neighbor of ours to the north, that we are going to become a destination for those seeking drinks at that last hour. And I don't think we need to wait for empirical evidence to know that that is not going to be good for the city of Revere." Mayor Ambrosino is a good lawyer with a good, very good education, and he's a fair guy. And if you know, if you listen to his statement, and he uses the word encompass, he means that this is unfair. If you're going to roll back and you're going to include everybody in an all-encompassing way, this is wrong. But he had a political problem and it's a public safety problem. He's on the board of Oakland. Population of 90,000 or 100,000. And he now feels he has that problem. So he says the empirical evidence, and that's how he couches it, it's off the hook, and it's in his state. If I make an analogy for you, if the Lynn Police Department show up at a three-bedroom house, three stories, and there's three families, one in each of the three, and they arrest somebody for a violent crime, assault and battery with a dangerous weapon, they don't go up on the second floor and arrest everybody. They don't go up on the third floor and arrest everybody. No, they arrest the person who they have probable cause to believe is the wrongdoer. Well, it strikes me that that analogy holds true with this rollback. Again, I go back to there is no systemic reason for the rollback. And they were treating everybody the same, not individually. I then went and I spoke to Secretary of the Revere Board. And she allowed me to say this, so I'm not talking out of school. I got her permission for this. The question to an answer that I had, she said, there are no citywide problems now, because you know in 2013 they went back to 2 o'clock. And that was the question. How did that affect the city of Revere? She said, no cause for going back, there was no cause for going back to 1 a.m. and none being considered. They are treating licenses one at a time. Do you have problems on the 2 o'clock license? She said, yes, we do. But not citywide. We have a problem with a major strip club. That can cause a problem at times, but they've been working with us all the time. We get along and things are going fine. And the beach sometimes has literally thousands of people in disparate origins, ages. There's so much confusion down there. There can be problems, but there's nothing that's. So I said, are they isolated? Did the city have any problems isolated? He said, yes. I then looked at Saugus. Saugus, as you know, has a population not anywhere near them. And they got into a heavy discussion. Once it's enrolled there, what do we do? Are we going to be a destination city if we stay in tour? Well, I did speak to the secretary of the board there. And she said that, yes, the discussion was, but did they ever really come down hard on rolling back? The answer is no. What they did is, in addition to punishing a wrongdoer, is that they had a suspension, they had a revocation, they could fine suspension and send it to the ABCC on appeal, the licensee, and they could get fined in lieu of. But what they did is they added another strategy. They said if the business was really a problem, but we think that there's hope for it, then what we did is we rolled them back to midnight. And this is another spread. We still liked the licensee. We thought that they were doing a good job, but they tripped up. But what we did is we rolled them back to one. But we always kept the 2 o'clock, the 2 o'clock lessons. We never excluded the role of that, notwithstanding that the same argument could be made. We were a destination town. We were not a destination town. We did not have that problem. We couldn't know that. They are content, she said, they are content with the current system. I don't doubt that statistic that comes from him for a second. I'd like to say, Lynn, I know the police department with all respect for her, legitimately, I'm not blowing smoke at her. But I believe that. The problem is that, what is the application? You can create all the statistics that you want. I take the 9% reduction. I take it back. But what's the implication of that? Mark Twain had said, he said there were lies, there were dim lies, and then there were statistics. He wasn't talking about the body of the statistics. He was talking about how they were applied. So my question to the chief would be, how much of the decrease is due to the several half dozen licensees in the city of Lynn that were real problems, consistent problems? That would be a question I would have. I would have another question. How much of that decrease is due to the good work that the police department has done on drugs and gang activity that affects the licensees in the town? And then another question was asked, how much is due to the 1 a.m. closing? His answer was, quote, a piece. Well, what's a piece? Piece at the rollback of every licensee, the best you can say about the 9% reduction is a piece, maybe the cause of the licensee, both licensees in Lynn. The chief goes on to argue that he says the closing and the 2 o'clock closing would make us a destination city. Well, it didn't make Revere a destination city, and it didn't make Saugus a destination city. So why, if Lynn has a 2 o'clock license, and Revere has a 2 o'clock license, and Saugus has a 2 o'clock license, why would Lynn be a destination city if you got a 2 o'clock? So he went on to say, there's a domino effect. And the domino effect is prostitution, eateries, in convenience stores. So in other words, if I'm drinking in the city of Lynn and there's a 1 o'clock closing and I leave, am I more apt to look for a prostitute at one than two? If I'm hungry, am I more apt to cause a problem in an eatery? If it's a 1 o'clock closing or a 2 o'clock closing? If it's a convenience store and I need something? Is it affected by whether or not I go to that convenience store after 1 o'clock closing or 2 o'clock closing? He went on to say, because I think he is a fair guy, he said, quote, a lot of the owners run a tight ship. Well, if a lot of the owners run a tight ship, and you know the previous chief said that they work well in the SIU, and you know that the chairman of the previous board said the same thing, why did they roll back? Well, I'll finish by saying that I think that all of the meetings, all of the hearings, all of the discussion, for months on end, we summed up in 8 words. And they were spoken by the former chairman of the board. And he said this, quote, this is not a finding on any establishment in the rollback. Well, that's the problem. They didn't make a finding on anybody that was a related to me. They made a finding on everybody. So anyone who violated, anyone who was a problem with Lynn, vis-a-vis the goals of compliance, but that 1 o'clock went out. Again, stay his words. This is not a finding on any establishment. 100% right. It's a finding on everybody, whether they deserve it or they didn't deserve it. It was a finding on them. So, again, I will say thank you very much for allowing me to speak and give me the time to say that.
Good evening, members of the licensing board. Good evening. My name is Frances Martinez, Executive Director, CEO of the North Shore Latino Business Association, located at 33 Sutton Street in Lynn, established in 2011 with 263 members, Latinos and non-Latino businesses. I would like to present a couple of points that we believe you should take into consideration. The North Shore Latino Business Association meets frequently with restaurants and nightclubs owners to discuss their needs and troubles. One of their frustrations is how they are affected by just 1 hour of no business. When the city of Lynn decided to roll back the hours to 1 o'clock, we know and understand that back then there was presence of violence in the city, especially gang violence in some nightclubs were definitely a problem. But at the present time, that is not the case. We congratulate the police department and the law to hide business owners for the tremendous reductions in violence in the city that the city have achieved. The beautiful city of Lynn is the ninth largest city in Massachusetts, in which, in so many ways, we have the beach. In so many ways, we have the beach, the Lynnwoods, and the most important, the diversity that makes our city unique. But our nightlife is basically to 12:30 last call for the nightclubs, and by 1 o'clock everyone should be out. Our next door neighbors, Revere, closes at 2, and that attracts residents to go for that extra hour, which in many cases can cause vehicle accidents when they re-enter the city, and obviously that demands presence of our police officers. The North Shore Latino Business Association support 100% the proposal of Mrs. Judith Lanigan Kennedy, Honorable Mayor of the City of Lynn, for a trial that will figure out if we can obtain the reductions of violence, which still will be helping businesses and the economy. But if we don't try, we will never know. The Lynn Police Department have 183 police officers. The third working shift takes place between 9 p.m. and 5 p.m. So even if we consider extending the hours, closing time, it will happen during the same shift. The city is growing in so many ways. New investors with great innovations and fabulous concepts are interested in to start potential businesses in the city, in the new land. But when they see that nightlife closes so early, they think twice to direct themselves to other nearby cities. Our nightclub businesses owners are severely affected by the hours. Many have been able to provide employment to local residents for now, for the past, basically 18 months, for the past months. They've been obligated to lay off more than half of their staff because clients are not staying in Lynn. A majority of are putting their business on the market because they can't continue losing money. We think it's a shame that vendors that work so hard to build their businesses and have been contributing to the Lynn development are struggling to make it. We ask you strongly to consider extending the hours to 2 a.m. on a trial basis. Thank you.
Okay, at this time, we will hear from public speakers that are in favor of the 2 a.m. closing. Please be reminded that you have 3 minutes. Please come to the podium and state your name, address, and please sign it.
Paula Prince.
Paula Prince,
1','     My name is Leslie Gould. I live at 372 Essex Avenue in Gloucester. I am the president and CEO of the Lynn Area Chamber of Commerce, and I've been so for the past 8 years. The Lynn Area Chamber of Commerce mission is to support business vitality and job creation. We are committed to listening to our members and working to understand the initiatives that concern them and the broad business community. Over the past 8 years, there has been no issue that has been more prevalent than the rollback of the Lynn restaurant and bar operating hours. This has a very negative impact on our local restaurant and bar establishments, as you've heard. We need to keep our local businesses on as much of a level playing field as possible to be competitive in this world. Thus, we should be in line with the operating hours of our surrounding communities, like Revere and Saugus, so it's fair to all concerned. The Lynn Area Chamber of Commerce represents over 30 restaurants, 17 of which hold a full liquor license as well as an entertainment license. Let's give those restaurant owners that are working hard to accommodate their patrons in the community the opportunity to be successful in Lynn. On behalf of these members, the Lynn Area Chamber of Commerce respectfully requests your consideration for supporting the proposal outlined by Mayor Flanagan Kennedy's letter. I thank you so much for your consideration and your time this evening. Thank you.
Thank you.
Richard Wood, I'm a member of the Chamber of Commerce also, and a 25-year resident and a business owner in the city. And in 2008, when this all took place, I was a strong supporter of changing the hours to 1 o'clock. But as time has evolved, and I heard the plight of the restaurant owners, and really, been a board member of the chamber for the past 6 years. I've got to know a lot of them and understand the importance of their role in the community, the jobs they provide. Really, one of our main concerns in the chamber is jobs, and jobs in Lynn for Lynn residents. And I believe that the conditions that the mayor has set out, especially the fact that no one is allowed at after 12:30, and I think that will change things dramatically. And that, you know, there'll be 35 years ago or so, I was running from Salem to Lynn at 1 o'clock, and I understand that mentality. I vaguely remember it. But I think that that condition alone is really what changed my mind. And just knowing the plight of the business owners and the importance of the jobs, as stated, that you know, a lot of people were laid off, and this will create Lynn as more of a destination early on in the evening, and should fuel more jobs for our restaurant owners. And our restaurant owners play a really important role in our community, and they're big supporters. And I feel like it's time to roll it back. So thank you.
My name is Calvin Anderson, 12 Concord Street in Lynn, and I spoke at the original hearing, what was it, 6 or 7 years ago, and I was citing some of the examples successfully incorporated as, you know, by the industry itself. Remember, this is an industry, this is hospitality industry, this isn't just bar, this includes restaurants, that, you know, which really appeals to me more because I'm usually in bed like that. This really doesn't affect me personally, but I see that it affects my neighbors and the vitality of our community. And the one important issue with this, I mean, the criteria for this is the no readmission after 1:30. Then one fell swoop gets rid of the idea that, oh, the people that'll leave other bars already arriving and trying to serve our city. So, and I also like the idea that this is a trial program. And I've been reading in our newspaper that the past few years there's been some limited, case by case, establishment by establishment, softening on such nights as like New Year's Eve, etc. So let's just give this a try. The restaurateurs and the industry want to police itself. It's been statistic to death, but it all comes back to it's a few troublemakers. And let's just make sure that there are many, because Revere is the model. That sounds really good, having those different criteria. You know, go back to 1, go back to 12. It's a self-policing industry, but the thing is remember, and this was the stress of the last year, you're not just cutting back 1 hour when you cut back from 12 to 1. That's 365 hours a year. That can make it right now.
To all of the business owners who need requesting more economy to come to the city. And as well, I've seen that the city of Lynn during the past 5 years has been a quiet environment for all of us. Thank you.
What is your address?
1 City Home Square.
I'm still 38 year young drive, lifelong Lynner, businessman for 30 years in the city of Lynn. I like Mayor Jody's letter. I like the thoughts that Attorney Fred Rodney put forward. You know, it's a different time, different era. I have a lot of my customers asking on the entertainment nights, could we stay a little bit later? You know, like we have a babysitter for the night. We take an Uber home, we this, we that, you know, so. It's, I think it's, you know, the trial basis protects everybody. Give it a shot. It's a couple of nights, and if it goes well, it continues. If it doesn't go well, then there's going to be reasons why, and you can look at them and point to those. But I like Andrew's letter, and again, I like what Fred Riley had presented. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity. Tom Dill.
Hi, my name is the chairperson of the panel.
Good evening, everybody here today. My name is Felix Martinez, and I've been here with Mayor Flynn for the last 30 years. I'm supporting Mayor's proposal because I believe there are three important elements. The number one element is, you know, the extending of the hours not only is going to bring revenue to the city, also is going to bring revenue to some family that are going to be supported by the jobs. I think, you know, we understand the great concern that the city has about public safety, but we also trying to survive. I mean, that hour that has been taken off, it'll make a difference. It'll make a difference for many, many families. It'll make a difference for many, many business owners. And I think we need to sit down and talk about this. Let's have open mind. We leave in a diversity city. Lynn has been developing through the last 20 years. It's a great city to live. It's a beautiful city. I think tonight we're going to take this opportunity for each side to view the whole concept and go back and think about it and renegotiate this, because I think it's important for the city. I think it's important for the people that try to survive in the city. Thank you.
Would you please sign it? Thank you. Lynn Anderson, thank you very much.
Safe nightlife is an important part of revitalizing our downtown. And I think the city, in most of its decisions over the last 10 years, agrees with that. First, we had the change in the zoning ordinance to allow many of our then vacant buildings to be converted into residential condos. The change in downtown, after this one change, was immediate and long lasting, still going on strong now. The residents that came in stayed and helped build downtown. Since then, we've also seen this auditorium turn into a first-rate entertainment destination. What was the purpose of that? To bring people downtown. Right? Follow that with the fact that the city sought and has received designation as a cultural district, one of the few in the state. Again, the idea is to make Lynn a destination. We currently have EDIC and LPN developing the old Atlas stationary building into artist lots, right? Create new living spaces for the creative economy to come downtown. And now we're hearing, you know, the buzz is that the city wants to really bring in more market rate housing downtown. And when you talk market rate housing, you're talking, for the most part, young professionals. And young professionals and artists, you know, who have been priced out of Boston, Cambridge, and some of them. And so you have artists on one hand, young professionals on the other. What you're talking about, again, is vibrant and not. There's both a product of those demographics and an enticement for those demographics. So I speak very strongly that I think for the overall economic development of the city, this is a win-win.
My name is Franklin Dunker. I want to make a little short story about what happened one night. I live in Boston, and a group of friends, about 15 or 16, come to my house for a celebration. And at 12 o'clock in the night, we went to go to dinner. And what I'm afraid of, a restaurant here, and I tried to come over here to have dinner. When we came in, they said, it's late, the house is closed about 30. So I'm in favor of the way that the house is closed. So that won't happen to me again.
What is your address?
My name?
You live at your address?
No, I live in Boston.
Okay, what's the address?
105 Fulton Street.
Fulton Street.
North End.
North End. Right up, your name and address. Thank you very much.
Peter Rupo, 583 Western Ave. I'm a landlord here in the city and surrounding communities. The economic revenue that is derived from restaurants and bars is substantial to the city. So substantial that I've been considering of selling my property here in Lynn and moving to be a landlord in other cities. It just helps out with the tax base, the renters I get, and the rents I can charge, the rents they can afford, and that's all I gotta say. It's pretty decent.
My name is Alberto Vargas-Requez. I'm living in the city over 25 years. I understand is we have a conversation for different businesses in Lynn. They were talking about we need one more hours on the standard hours for this whole restaurant, because even me myself, I work 50 hours a week, 40 hours a week, 60. And sometimes I have to drive to Sargis, to Revere, to enjoy more hours. The city of Lynn, for 25 years that I live here, they don't have enough sport things for people to enjoy. So I'm just dancing. My hobby is dancing. And I like to dance. And I have to fly, I have to drive to different towns to enjoy my life. So I'm working also so contract for the city of Lynn, we appreciate it if you guys stay there.
What is your address?
465 Essex Street, Lynn.